Good morning. It's good to see you here this morning, Erlanger Baptist. It's Colossians 3:16, let the word of Christ dwell richly within you, and with all wisdom and teaching and admonishing one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual psalms, singing with thankfulness in your heart to God. God has given us much to be thankful for. Let's stand as we sing, He Keeps Me Singing. There's within my heart a melody, Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in a love life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. All my life was wrecked by sin and strife, discord filled my heart with pain. Jesus wept across the broken strings, slurred the slumbering chords again. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Though sometimes He leads through waters deep, trials fall across the sometimes the path seems rough and steep, see His footprints all the way. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Thank you. You may be seated.
Good morning. How are we doing this morning? Is everyone glad to be here? That's awesome. Why are you glad to be here?
Because you're going to preach.
Okay, you win. She said, because you're going to preach. Isn't that sweet? That's awful nice. Why else are you here now that we've gotten that one out of the way? We get to worship, what? The ladies' tea afterwards. All right, I'm not real excited about that one, but, you know, it's okay. What else? Jesus, music. Be with other people. Can I tell you, that's one of my favorites, is the fact that we get to be together. There is something about the fact that we get to come together and sing and lift our voices together. I mean, besides a rock concert or something where people get together and sing, this is not a normal thing that people do every week, right? When we get together, we get to sing, lift our voices together, be encouraged together. We get to open up God's word together. We get to see what He says to our congregation and to us individually. Like, this is an incredible thing. And we get to do that based on a God who absolutely loves and adores us and has sent His Son, Jesus Christ, who has shown His love, demonstrated it, and offered it to us who are completely messed up too often. And we have a Jesus who, because of what He does in His grace, affords us the opportunity to be in relationship with Him and to continue to grow closer to Him every day. Man, that's good news. And so I hope and I pray that you're here for that reason, that you are here because you have a God that you know personally because of what Jesus Christ has done and how it's been applied to your life, that you come into this place ready to join in. And it keeps me singing, right? That there is truly a melody in your heart, that throughout this week you've been able to worship, and that so that this morning is an overflow of what's been going on in your time of worship throughout the week as you've lived out your Christian walk with a God who indwells you with this Holy Spirit. If you're visiting this morning, we're glad that you're here, and we hope that you see Jesus. We hope that you see His kingdom on display, a picture of what it's to be like as His people gather under a message that is bigger than any one person's purpose and calling. We have something that unites us because it's so much bigger than all of us, that we surrender ourselves to be a part of it. We are here to worship. We are glad that you are here with us. Would you pray as we continue? Father, thank you for this morning, and thank you that we get to be here. We get to come into this place because of what Jesus has done. We get to proclaim that, but by the grace of God go I. That we get to proclaim Jesus Christ. And we get to lift our voices together. And so I pray you help us to sing out. We get to come into this place and worship in spirit and in truth. And so I pray that you would preach to us through your word. You would speak. You would feed your people, even as we desire to come and be a blessing to you. Lord, as we look out across this room, we see family. A family that is united not by blood of just a lineage, but by a blood of a Savior. One that you now unites us for all of eternity. This is our family. And Lord, we are a picture of that, of what you have done across this world in saving people, a people of your own possession, that those without hope would have hope. And so I pray you'd help us to worship. Help us to enjoy this time. And God, may you be glorified even as we just enjoy being in your presence among your people. And God, if there is someone here who does not know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord this morning, God, would you make them one of yours? In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
truly Christ is Lord. In Galatians 2:20 we read, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. The life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me. We're going to sing a song which says, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Let's stand as we sing. What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my only hope is Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to his. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken. For by my side, the Savior, he will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need, his power is displayed. To this I hold, my shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley he will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. I dread, but I am forgiven. The future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and he was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are released. I can sing, I am free. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. With every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home. And day by day, I know he will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, all the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ. deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away, as wounds which for the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon His shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held Him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom. But this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Good morning. It's good to see you. Today, as we continue in the series Moving Forward, Pastor BJ is going to be talking about overcoming distraction. Like, you might be distracted right now because the choir is moving. You might not be listening to me, but watching them. Focus here. So yes, we're going to be talking about that. What does it mean to be distracted? Well, let me give you an example. Have you ever been talking on the phone? Oh, hi, yeah, it's good talking to you. Missed you, yes. And someone comes up to you, approaches you, and asks you a question while you're talking on the phone. You have a choice to make. You can either continue to talk on the phone and ignore them, or you can be like, oh, yes, red's my favorite color. Oh, what? What were you saying? Has that ever happened to anyone? Yes, it happens to me constantly, and I struggle because I think they're important, but they're important too. And usually it's like, hold on, Kelly, because that's what happens in my life. But we have to make a choice. But guys, I can't listen to this person and that person at the same time. It's just not possible. I've tried, and it never works. I answer their question to her, or are you talking to me? No, I'm talking to... Anyway, so there's one example. Another example might be you're reading your favorite book, and you love this book. You've been trying to finish it, and you're so close. Let's pretend like you're here, and you're so close, but it's time to go somewhere. You have a meeting, and if you don't leave now, you're going to be late for the meeting, and the meeting's just down the hall and up the stairs, so you think, well, maybe I can finish the book while I'm going to the meeting. And so you try to, okay, I'm just going to keep reading this book. And all along, you have to dodge things. And then stairs come, and you're like, huh, can I go down the stairs and keep reading? So what's going to happen is either I'm not going to remember anything I read in the last chapter, or I'm going to trip and fall, or I'm going to run into something or knock over something. It's just going to be a disaster. Another example that just happened to me last night. My wife went on a little trip, and she came back home, and so we were talking, because when husbands and wives are apart, they like to talk when they come back together. And I have a 2-year-old that the whole time is going, Dada, 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 Dada. And I'm trying to have this conversation with my wife. Yes, what happened? Dada, Dada. I'm like, it was really hard, and I have no idea what happened on her trip, because he wanted my attention. He needed it. So anyway, there's some examples. Hopefully you're tracking with me on what distraction is. And we see distraction in the Bible as well. In Matthew chapter 14, Jesus had just fed more than 5,000 people with five loaves and two fish. I'm sure most of you have heard that story before. And after that amazing miracle happened, he sent the disciples on ahead of him in a boat to travel across to the other side of the water. Meanwhile, he spent some time alone with God praying. Now, while the disciples were on the boat, the wind was blowing really hard, and there started wind and water, waves were happening, and so the disciples were being beaten by the waves, and Jesus happened to notice that his friends were having a hard time on the boat, and so he decides to walk out to them. Now, yes, you heard me right. He walked out to them. They're in the water. He's on the land. He walked out to them. So he was walking on the water. Yes. Walking on the water. So listen, starting in verse 26 of chapter 14 in Matthew, it says, "But when the disciples saw him walking on the water, they were terrified and said, 'It's a ghost!' And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, 'Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid.' And Peter answered him, 'Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water.' And Jesus said, 'Come.' So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, 'Lord, save me!' Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him." Did you see the distraction in that story? Peter was in the midst of doing the most amazing thing in his life. He was walking on water. But instead of embracing the moment, "Look at me, I'm walking on water," just enjoying, "Look what's happening to me, someone take a picture," he sees the wind, and he immediately takes his focus off of Jesus to the wind, and he begins to get afraid. And what happens to him? He begins to sink. He can't walk on the water and look at the wind at the same time. He has to do either or. Don't you know that? Everybody knows you can't walk on the water and do anything else. So he got distracted, and he made a choice in the moment to take his eyes off of Jesus, and he began to sink. Instead of choosing Jesus, he chose fear and worry. The same thing happens to all of us. In our relationship with Jesus, Jesus has a plan for us. There's things that he wants for us to do. And in order for us to do those things, we need to be focused in his direction. Too often, we try to do both. We try to look to him and something or someone else. And in most cases, we get distracted from Jesus and give our focus away. It's just like this cup of water. Now, this isn't actually a cup. It's a vase. But I couldn't find a glass cup. So I got a vase. I'm going to drink out of the vase right now. So I have this straw. I cleaned it, though, so it doesn't have flower juice in it or anything. So I'm going to drink from this straw. It's really easy, nice, refreshing, cold ice water. Drink. Now, let's say I get another straw here, and I put it on the outside of the glass, and I try to drink from both. I got no water. No water's coming. What do you think's coming into my mouth? Air. Did you know that? I didn't believe it either. I saw an example and I thought, I got to try that. That's not true. It is true. You cannot drink out of this glass and with one straw out. Every time I'm getting water. No, I'm getting air. Excuse me. I'm getting air. So the point is, if I'm trying to drink this water and trying to do something else, it's not going to work. I'm not going to get the water. And so if you think about Jesus is the living water and we need to drink from him, but so often we're trying to, well, let me just do this other thing real quick. We're not getting Jesus. We're getting whatever this is. So if I want to drink this water, what do I need to do? Get rid of that and drink. Yes. That's good stuff. So the illustration, the point of this is quit trying to do everything. Get focused on Jesus. He has something for you to do, and we're so easily distracted by what's coming, what's going on around us, by our worries and our fears, that we aren't investing and spending time with Jesus, doing the things that he wants for us to do. In Deuteronomy 6:5, it says, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might." Now, he knows that we're going to be doing other things, but he wants to be a part of those things. So let's keep our focus on him, and he can turn our distractions into blessings. So let's pray. God, I thank you so much for this message. It's good for me because I am a distracted person, and so often I think, I was going to do this, this, and this, and instead I did this, this, and this. And so often I'm trying to spend time with you, and I let distractions pull me away. And I know, Lord, I'm not alone. There are other people that need to overcome distraction. And so I pray today, as we listen to Pastor BJ, as he goes into your word, that you'd speak directly to us and show us how to overcome distraction. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
I was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost. I was blind. I was running out of time. Sin separated. The breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you had me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide, left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. There at the cross, you paid the debt I owed, broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had hope. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood of life. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life, brought me from the darkness into glorious light. You took my place, laid inside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. Now death has no sting, and life has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood of the Lamb. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood of life. Thank you.
those are some good words that we sang and heard today. And I hope that you receive them and embrace them and live in light of them. If you have your Bibles, if you would open to 2 Timothy chapter 2. We are continuing our series, Moving Forward. Last week, I preached a message, and it was entitled, Moving Forward Through Adversity. And one of the things that I wanted to kind of bring to light was we recognize that adversity is just part of the human experience. And thus, it is a means for divine purpose. And so today, my goal is to kind of do the same thing. It is not just to overcome distractions, but to overcome and move forward through distraction. As Pastor Eric alluded to, we are a very easily distracted people. I know that we talk about distracted drivers now. There are times where my phone will tell me, my little Allstate app will tell me, you used your phone while you were driving, and it marks me down on my little discount. But there is you're sitting there in your car, and you're like, I might as well have a mobile office, right? I could check email, make phone calls, plan my calendar. Siri can do some of those things, and so I let her. But we find ourselves very easily getting distracted. We're doing all of those things, and in the background, Google Maps is trying to get me from point A to B as well. It happens. Distraction is anything that would prevent you from giving your full attention to something else. And so there's lots of different kinds of distractions, whether it's my phone, whether it's my watch, whether it's all the email accounts, the television, you can add on. Just think about today. Right now, all the things that you are thinking about. It might be lunch already. It might be the afternoon activities, your evening plans, the week ahead, groceries that you need to purchase, the women's tea that's coming up, or maybe it's an afternoon meeting that you have to attend. You realize that all of these things can take away from the moment that we're in right now. And so we actually design our corporate worship to help us get from la to this, right? Normally, we will start our service with a more upbeat, moving song because you're coming in, you're talking with people, we know you're moving, there's a lot going on, and so we kind of embrace the energy and go with it. And then our goal is to kind of bring us settled down, hearing the words, whether it's reading through Scripture, whether it's praying, whether it's singing a slower song, to get us to a point where we're ready to listen. Distractions can be very bad things in our lives. Pastor Eric alluded to the fact that there are times that it draws us away by sucking air instead of drawing in Christ. But they can also be a means by which God intends to work. And the reality is that even as we keep our eyes on God, distractions are going to come. And how we move forward in light of them reveals much about how we're functioning and defining those events. And so I want to use this passage out of 2 Timothy chapter 2, 1 through 7, to kind of preach a message on distraction. And it's not going to be just the simple remove all the distractions message. Many of us know that. We know there are distractions in our lives. And so, you know, you sit there and say, Pastor BJ, I actually already know this one. I'm going to skip out because there's a couple things that I need to do. We know that gig, right? I want to spin it a little bit differently this morning and maybe help us think about distraction differently. So if you have your place, if you would stand and let's read 1 through 7 together. It says, you therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. The things which you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. Suffer hardship with me as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No soldier in active services entangles himself in the affairs of everyday life so that he may please the one who enlists him as a soldier. Also, if anyone competes as an athlete, he does not win the prize unless he competes according to the rules. The hardworking farmer ought to be the first to receive his share of the crops. And so consider what I say, for the Lord will give you understanding in everything. Will you pray with me? Father, I thank you for this morning. I thank you for the chance that we have had to worship through song, through prayer, maybe even through our giving already. And now I ask that you'd help us to worship as we sit under your word, that we would be active in our participation, hearing what you would have to say to us and submitting ourselves and surrendering ourselves to what you have for us this morning. I thank you for each person and for the journey that they are on in this room, and for the next steps that they will take as they desire to move forward in whatever you are calling and however you are working in their lives. I pray that today would be a day where we hear from you, and then that it is a day in which you give us grace to respond. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Verse 1, it begins with, "You therefore." You always look back on what is the therefore, therefore. And so when you do that, you are seeing that he has given him some early command, some early calling, reminded him of truth that is in his life. And so he's saying, of all these things, now that you are stewards of this gospel and you are called and equipped with the Holy Spirit to live out this life, therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. So the first thing I see here, what Paul is getting at, is he says, the strength and the source of the Christian life is found in and through Christ Jesus. I mean, we know this. But he's referencing back to chapter 1, 8 and 9. He says, therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord or of me as prisoner, but join with me in suffering for the gospel according to the power of God who saved us. Right, he's referencing back. And then in chapter 1, verse 14, he goes on to say, so then guard through the Holy Spirit who indwells you. So he's recognized already in chapter 1 twice that the source of their calling, of their salvation, and of their mission is all sourced by the power of Christ. It is grace. Grace is the power of God in our lives. It is not just that which covers us, but it is an introduction that we received at the point of salvation, that we walk in light of it, and we receive grace from the throne when we have time of need. That's what Hebrews says. Facing distraction and allowing distraction to be ministry requires an attentiveness and a life source fit for the task. We have to have a source that is fit for the task of being able to see things from a perspective and be empowered to live life in those moments from a perspective of grace. Paul reinforces the idea that the end results are met head on with the presence and power of the Holy Spirit in us. And the grace, not of ourselves, but in Christ, as we even sang about. It means that we constantly are drinking from Him. He is the vine. We are the branches. Overcoming through distraction, then, becomes an exercise in the Spirit, by the power of the Spirit, for the work of the Spirit. And so I want us to see distraction not for things that take us away but give us opportunity. But if we're going to see distraction from a spiritual perspective, we must have a spiritual headship that guides us. And so Paul centers his young student on the grace of God. This is how we move forward. Second verse, he says, the things which you've heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. Second thing is this, constant clarification of the mission keeps distractions as the means and not the ends. It's going to keep them the means, not the ends. Paul is writing to this Timothy in the midst of everything that's going on, and he can add all of his distractions on as well in his own life. You have all of yours in your life. And if we let those become the ends, we've missed it. And so he's reminding him of the purpose. You are called with a calling to pour into others who will pour into others. This sounds like discipleship to me. For Timothy, his calling is to propagate the gospel through leading church leadership. He's called to discipleship. That's his mission. This here is for a pastor maybe pouring into other people who will be able to teach, so other kind of pastors. But this is a universal thing for all of us. We've been talking about this all year long. Family-led ministry. Leading your family unit. Walking in the Lord and passing along faithfully the truth of Scripture to the next generation. We're called to be doing the same thing that that he is being called here to do. In this context, it appears that Timothy is doing this like called ministry of maybe future elders, equipping and replacements for the next generation. But that's exactly what we do with our families. We have to know our purpose and our calling. These things have to be clear because they put distraction in its proper place. If our callings are not the goal, then we miss the mark. But if our distractions become the goal, then they start messing everything up. They must be the means through which we do the work. So when we forget the greater purpose and calling, the distractions, whether they are weighty or trivial, they gain too much of our focus. And they start to resemble our ends rather than the items along the way. But that's why we're called to come back day after day to the Word of God. That's why we're called week after week to come back into this place and to worship in a corporate setting with Bible study, fellowship. We're called to keep our eyes on Jesus and on the purpose that He calls us to. Constantly clarifying the mission helps us put distraction into the context of being a means and not our ends. Look at the third verse. Suffering hardship with me as a good soldier in Christ. Then he goes on to explain it. No soldier in active service entangles himself in the affairs of everyday life so he may please the one who enlists him as a soldier. Third thing I want you to see is this. Our calling gives us the lens to evaluate and respond to life experiences. Our calling gives us the lens to evaluate and respond. So we can't stop distractions. They're going to happen. But how we evaluate them and how we see them is dictated by who we know we are and how we are to respond. There is no separation between secular and sacred. And so growth and vital ministry are going to happen in all of the distractions of the everyday. I mean, think about Jesus for just a second. How many of his miracles, his parables, his discourses happened in disruptions? Happened at moments that were inconvenient. I remember one of the stories, he's like absolutely worn out. He gets his disciples and he's like, okay, we're going to go across the river, or across the sea. We're going to rest a little bit. We're going to get away. And it says, knowing that he'd left, the crowd went ahead of him to the other side and was ready when he got there. I'm going, oh my goodness. But you know what? He didn't look at that distraction and go, oh, I don't have time for you. He just went into it. And he loved them. He had compassion on them. How many times did it seem like chance that he was just there and what happened was seamlessly just kind of random along the road? When a crowd would gather, when a storm would pop up, when a confrontation was made. Yeah, there was a general course and flow to Christ's ministry, where he deliberately chose to go from one place to another. But if you look at the stories that are recorded, a lot of them are along the way. And when a crowd happened to gather in a different location. The divine sidebars of those 3 years, you see Jesus just taking advantage of the moment. and letting God be seen. Conversely, Peter in that boat, right? He initially responds to the call, but he's distracted by the wind. He begins to sink. He cries for help. He takes his eyes off Jesus. And he has to call out for his master to come. And we can assume that the distractions of the wind caused a disturbance in Peter's life. It led to fear. And let's be honest, probably a confrontation with his own personal inadequacy. Like, oh my, I'm walking on water. How long can I really hold that up? Right? Now there's wind. There's probably some waves going on. How am I doing this? Do I step over the waves? What is going on? You can think of all the details that he's now brought before him because he's taken his eyes off Jesus and he's trying to mitigate in the details. And the distraction brings him to fear, and his fear begins to sink. I have to tell you, though, I'm really grateful for Jesus in that story. Aren't you? In the midst of that, he cries out, and it says immediately Jesus took him and brought him and put him in the boat. Like, there wasn't like, well, if you'd kept your eyes on me, hope you're doing okay down there. Take a deep breath before you go under. It's dark down there. Jesus met him, even in that failure. Life is full of distractions. And they often and are regularly used to change our lens and the way we see things. But I believe distractions become the means and the opportunity for gospel living. And I want you this morning to think about all the distractions that you face and ask the question, are you seeing them as a means and an opportunity to live out the gospel? I think this is huge for us as we move forward. We cannot completely remove them. Jesus did not completely remove them. He embraced them and did some of his most incredible things in the midst of them. The analogy that Paul gives here is of a soldier. His training and his calling to military changes the way that he interprets life. He sees himself and he determines who he is and how he responds to those normal day activities based on the calling that he has. If you've known someone who's ex-military or someone who's been in either a cop or something, I remember going out to lunch with a gentleman, and he always goes into the room and he always sits in a corner looking out across the room. He's like, you sit there, I'll sit here. I'm like, okay, odd, you tell me where to sit. Or he'll just make sure that he's there first and sits down. It's because he has a different perspective and mentality. He has been trained to watch the room and to know everything that's going on. And so he's going to put himself in a position where he doesn't have a blind spot and he has view of the room. Here I am, okay, I'm just going to eat my food. I'll stare at the wall. I have no idea what's going on behind me. That's why we have a safety ministry team. But think about it. That military background sees everything as military. It's one reason PTSD is such a difficult thing, because you've come out of that intensity, and trying to just become civilian again is really, really hard to unprogram. But for a Christian, when we become a Christian and we're getting programmed by Christ by spending time with him, it's not something we want to come out of, but it's something that now we see through that lens all the time. This beautiful picture of identity preceding perspective matters for us. And that's what we are as believers. We are Christians who have been saved by God's grace. And so therefore, when we see a distraction, we don't see it as an enemy, but maybe an opportunity. We don't see it as Peter and the disciples looking at those lepers and saying, be quiet, be quiet. We're trying to do this. And he's crying out all the more. And he says, shh, he's busy. He's doing important things. And Jesus saying, no, let him come to me. Or the children, no, get him back, kids. Permit the kids to come to me. I mean, how many times did Jesus have to go to a distracted moment and the disciples are like trying to, you know, don't let him back, let Jesus do his thing. And Jesus going, that's my thing. He's on that side. Get him over here. How many times are we looking at people that come into our lives as distractions from getting something done, and they're actually the thing that we're supposed to be doing that day? I will tell you, as I've been building this barn, I'm outside. So people like to honk at you when you're going by. Hey! And I have no idea who any of them are, but they assume that they know me, so I wave. And there are times where people come by. Over. So Miss Burt, she lives across the street. When Miss Burt comes over to check on my barn, I know the next 30 minutes we're done. I got a break. Now, I could be sitting there really annoyed with Miss Burt. She's like, come on, come on. I got to get back to this. There was a pastor that stopped by. I'm like, holy cow, she was there, he was there. I'm going, I only have so many hours, pure people. But isn't it true? We'll do that. We get caught up and we see the distractions as annoyances and frustrations. And we begin to have people become annoyances and frustrations because we have our own kingdom and our own design and our own purposes and plans and to-do lists. I wonder how many times did Jesus set out with a to-do list that the disciples had given him? And Jesus said, that's not on the list. This is going to happen today. How do you see your distractions? Do you see all of life as an opportunity to be living out the gospel so that every engagement is a chance for you to share Christ and to be Christ and to let Christ shine through you? The next verse, he goes in and says, if anyone competes as an athlete, he does not win the prize unless he competes according to the rules. And so what I want to take from this is our response and activity is guided by a worldview shaped and informed by Scripture. Our response and the activity when we are confronted with a distraction has got to be shaped and informed by Scripture. The athlete has to follow the rules. We have a guide that is given to us. And so the way we handle what could be a distraction and do that in a way that is honoring to the Lord and takes and lets the Lord use that moment for whatever He has purposed is by living consistent and in line with our calling and purpose. Things can either entangle us or they can provide us moments for God to show through. A spouse, our kids, a house, a car, hobbies, sickness, career, finances, worries, daily needs. You ever been mad that you had to eat? You had to stop and eat? Or you had to sleep? Or that you couldn't use a miter saw after 9 p.m. because you had neighbors? I mean, it happens to some people. I don't know who they are. That you have to go to the bathroom. Can I just tell you, this is not on there. But I, as a child, I know you can't believe this, but did not like to stop. Using the bathroom was a frustration to me. And so I would hold it forever, trying to still do what I wanted to do. Because I was playing basketball or I was doing whatever. And so I came up with creative ways to like make me hold it. It's bad. It's pitiful. I don't know why I needed to go into that moment of confession. Thank you. But here's the thing. I can list all of those things. And I can see them as distractions. And I can see them as frustrations. But they have to become means and not ends. Do you realize that sleep is actually a means of worship? It's a time where you close your eyes and you entrust the world to a God who's bigger than you, who does not grow weary and tired like you. God uses these things in life, in our lives. And it has to then, as we look upon those things, not see them as ends, but as means. All right, I got done building a house, and now I've got this barn and the animals. And the other night, as I've been thinking about distractions, I took my wife out to the property. It was the night before we were going to get the goats. We have goats now. They're a distraction. And I done all this work. I got a fence ready. Got the barn. Doesn't have any siding yet, but it's getting there. And I said, you know, honey, we don't know what is going to be entailed in this process. But what I pray is this becomes a tool for ministry. And not just something that builds our own kingdom, and not just something that we want to take a hobby that detracts us. The other day I was working on my barn, and four youth walked by. These are four youth that you, by looking at them, knew they were punks. They, turns out they weren't in, only one of them was in a regular school. The rest were like in an academy or whatever because of their punkiness. And they just walked by, and before they got by, I yelled at them. I said, are you not even going to stop and look at my barn? And they're like, do what? I'm like, seriously, I'm working really hard over here. Come look at my barn. They're like, we can come and look at it? I'm like, yeah. I brought them in, and I had them climbing on it and in it. I told them about the goats that were coming. I said, stop by and see my goats. I'd love to have you come and see my goats when they come. They said, you serious? Like, we can come? Yes, and if I'm not out, just knock on the door. I'll come out, and I'll show you my goats. And I told my son, I said, those could be the kids that vandalized my building, but I'm going to preemptively love them and invite them in. And I'm not going to see them as a distraction or a nuisance to get away from me. But I want my property and my family to be a place of ministry. And that means it's going to have distractions. And I'm all for getting a task done in a timely manner. But I'll tell you, building this last house, I've learned to chill out and to let things happen and not be so consumed by getting done. Because God is working in the details more than he is in that just that finished product. And God did things in me. So thus for us, I would tell you, distractions are the spontaneous evidence then of a life that's in and controlled by the Spirit, because that's what is happening. When you have that moment, when Paul says, man, may the grace of Jesus Christ do all of these things, how you're responding to distraction says a lot about how much the Spirit is living through us and taking those moments. And so I want to challenge you, and I want to encourage you. Because look at this next verse. It says, the hardworking farmer ought to be the first to receive his share of the crops. I want you to see, there is joy and return in lives well lived and moments well invested. Certainly here in view is that Timothy is to be supported by the very ministry that he's seeking to lead and shepherd, for sure. That's there. It is worthy of to support a pastor in his position. But I believe the truism can be generalized to remind us of the joy of following Christ and enjoying him and the life that he gives us. There is to be a joy and a return on the investment given in the context of a moment that we don't need to reject or refuse. Embracing distraction for the purposes of God yields blessings in the moment. I think of Jesus with the woman at the well. And Jesus, the disciples come back and say, did you get anything to eat? He says, I have bread that you do not know about. I have food you do not know about. And he's just been ministering to this woman. And this woman is going off to share the gospel. And you see the joy in Jesus there. It's one of the reasons I've really enjoyed The Chosen, the video series that It's out there for you to watch through the app. If you haven't started, watch it. It's good. We were watching it together on Wednesday nights here, and I invite you to join in. It's a good one to come to. But I love Jesus just finding joy in the moments, not just at the end. Like when Peter is trying to get the fish onto the boat, and Jesus just has this smile, like, hee-hee. This divine moment, like, he knows what Peter's going to do, all the struggles it's going to be over, the headaches that it's going to be over the next 3 years. But he also knows what the end goal is, and he's enjoying the moments in the midst of it. And here is the farmer investing. And let's think about it. A farmer does do a certain level of investment and then waiting, right? Kind of watching, letting the Lord kind of raise the harvest, and at the end he gets to take up that harvest. But if you've ever gardened before and you've ever gotten it all laid out and all the rows planted, like there's joy just in that part. Like getting it all tilled up, get all the rows planted, get them all watered in, you're like, look at that. And all those distractions along the way. Do you have joy? It's not just about one day. The fruit of the Spirit is love and joy. Are you loving it or are you enjoying it? Like, if you want to sell me some theology or some belief or some position, and there's no joy in you, I don't want that. Because Jesus had joy. Jesus was one who worked through all of the adversities, and yet for the joy set before him, endured the cross. Like, he had joy. This is a joyful person. It was someone who tax collectors and sinners said, sign me up, I want to hang out with this guy. Not sign me up so he can chew me out and tell me all the ways that I need to get better. But he just loves me and he enjoys me. And because of that, he saved them. And so would people categorize you as someone who's full of joy? Final verse. Consider what I say, for the Lord will give you understanding in everything. Last thing is this. God is the one who opens our eyes to see the distractions as the opportunities. God's the one who does this. It is my prayer that those chance distractions can move from being an annoyance to an opportunity, from a frustration to a missional fulfillment, from a sidetrack to the conduit for the gospel. You take every moment and you redeem every moment. Living in the moment is essential because it's the only moment we have. And 2 weeks ago, we talked about how in decision, we trust God to order our steps, which means we need to also trust then that the encounters and the distractions are neither random nor purposeless. So what are the things that you need God to show you in the midst of your daily distractions as vessels and conduits for the gospel? Yes, there are some distractions that are self-induced and are sinful or are wrong or are things that detract you from your walk. Binge watching a certain television series that you really don't need to. Hobbies that you don't need to take up. Behavior patterns that need to be broken. There are some of those things. Certainly, things that so easily entangle us, as the writer of Hebrews would say. There are. Yes, there are some distractions in our lives that need to be overcome. They might be sin or addiction, things that we face. Maybe it's fear, whatever it is, that those things distract us and they take us away from our focus. Those are true. In other cases, I would argue that we have to move forward despite distractions, putting them in the context of the mission, not granting them some undue sway in our time and our efforts, our energies and emotions. But hear me this morning. In many cases, I think we move forward through distraction, realizing that so-called distractions of life are actually the ordered steps and the engagements of God for His purposes and His glory. It is through these moments, these hiccups, these adversities, that God brings about our sanctification and allows us to share our lives with those around us, which we would call divine appointments if we had the perspective. We will not get away from distractions. Some we need to walk away from, but always some will come. How are you using them to live out the gospel? More importantly, allowing the Holy Spirit to be on display in that moment for what He has divinely set up for you. Guess what? You have a distraction this week awaiting you. Therefore, you have the opportunity to let Jesus use that distraction for you and for others. Will you pray with me? Father, it's very easy for us to know that we are distracted people. And a lot of things, when we say it in that context, are things that we know we need to remove from our lives. But Lord, at the same time, just because we are human and we live on this earth, we interact with different people, with different situations, there will always be distractions, many that we can do nothing about but must be confronted with. And yet You're a God who is orchestrating all things, and so these distractions are not things that we just push away. These may be the very things that You have for us that day. God, make us more like Jesus. Make us willing to move forward through the distractions, to know You more, to let You be on display more. And God, may we entrust all the details and all the end results to You. God, make us people who love others. Make us people who are patient. Make us people who are joyful in the moment. So therefore, Lord, bring distraction, but bring it in a way that we see it in light of our calling and in light of the One who indwells us for that moment. God, I thank You for all the distractions we will face this week. And I pray that the gospel would come out, both in word and in deed. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
It's been good to be here this morning. Amen. 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 Thank you, BJ, for that word. I think, the Lord's golden retriever, constantly, cocker spaniel, whatever, constantly distracted. And so that was a word definitely for me. I hope you picked up a worship guide as you came in this morning. There's a lot of things on it, a lot of information. A couple of those we'll touch base on real quick. First of all, if you're a guest with us, we're so glad that you're here. I want to encourage you at the end of the service, especially if this is your first time, to go to the foyer and fill out a Connect card, just some information for us to be able to contact you, get a hold of you, and to know how we can come alongside you and your family in ministry, and we will only do what You give us permission to do on that card. So make sure if you're a first-time guest, you take advantage of that. And you can always find more information on our website at erlingerbaptist.org, which is also the place you can give online. And if you're going to give in person today, we have our offering plates here in the sanctuary. We also have drop boxes throughout the building if you're going to give in person today. The ladies' tea. Nobody's excited about the ladies' tea? The ladies' tea is after the service today, right through this door in the gymnasium. So if you're a lady, please take advantage of that and attend that today. And that is in the gym. There is also a Fargo mission trip interest meeting. Oh, I love that picture. Downtown. With me in the youth area right after the service. We're going to talk logistics about the Fargo mission trip. So if you're interested in that, When the service is over, head up to the youth area, which is also through this door, and then up the staircase to the third floor in the youth area, and we'll talk about the Fargo mission trip. The deadline to participate in graduate recognition, if you have a graduate in your life that you would like recognized, the deadline for us to know, so that way we can get a gift ordered and kind of get our little ceremony all set up. The deadline is today, so at some point by the end of today, shoot me a text or an email and say, hey, there's a student that I'd like to participate. The church picnic is coming June 6th, which is also the day of graduate recognition in a couple Sundays, so be ready for that. And then tonight, there's a CentraKid meeting at 6 p.m. in the Commons, correct? In the Commons? Yes. So make sure that you see Pastor Eric tonight at 6 p.m. if you have a child going to CentraKid. And the last announcement is be in prayer for Ralph Palmer's family. Ralph passed away this week, and we just celebrated his 100th birthday as a church. But he did go home to be with the Lord this past week. And the funeral arrangements are Tuesday visitation from 10:30 to 11:30. And then the service is at 11:30 at Stith Funeral Home on 42. So that's the information on that. If you need to hear that again, just contact the church office and we'll get that to you. Let's pray and we'll be dismissed. Father, thank you so much for this opportunity to gather as your people in this place. And Father, I know myself, it is super easy to become consumed and distracted by the things swirling around in my life, and I'm sure that most everybody else came in this room feeling the same way, that we have to-do lists to check off, that we have conversations to have, meetings to go to. But Father, I pray that you would allow us to look at those as opportunities, opportunities for ministry, opportunities for you to grow us and to pour into us. And so, Lord, I pray that you would help us to stay focused in that, not stay focused, you know, to eliminate distractions, but, Lord, to allow ourselves to be led by your Spirit through every moment of life, ready to hear from you and ready to do to allow you to do ministry through us. And so, Father, as we go out this week, I pray that the gospel would be on our lips and that we would share this news with our community and this world. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.